Stay tuned to meet a man that has an amazing story of redemption to tell. You won't want to miss it. My name is Yvonne Lewis, and you're watching Urban Report. Welcome to Urban Report. My guest today is Michael Harris, singer, author, and speaker. Welcome to Urban Report, Michael.
Thank you for having me here, Yvonne.
Oh, it's great to have you. Listen to that voice. Already you can tell that this man is a singer.
I've always enjoyed this telecast.
Well, praise the Lord.
Great job.
God is really so faithful. And you know that.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Because you know where he's brought you from.
I am blessed and highly favored.
Yes. Yes. Amen. Amen. Let's talk about where God brought you from.
Well, I was born in Indianapolis, Indiana, but I was raised in Chicago, the south side of Chicago, a place where you probably wouldn't want to have an accident or a flattened tire. Mm. It's a very gang and drug infested community, a place where I practically had to fight my way to and from school every single day.
You know, Michael, I was watching some documentary or some program not too long ago. Oh, it was a program on another Christian network where they were talking about this family in Chicago and how they lost both of their sons in the span of like 3 weeks to gangs.
Yes, the death rate is so high on the south side of Chicago. Every weekend, a couple of hundred kids are killed by way of gang violence. And I say right now, stop the violence, and we need to come together and come up with a conclusion to all this pain and hate.
Yes.
There's so many young black kids and Hispanic kids who are just falling by the wayside because of their decisions to be a part of gang activities. And a lot of those guys are not involved in gangs. Some of them are just going to and fro like I was trying to do in my life. I was constantly approached by gangbangers because of my size, my height. But thanks be to God, he was with me every step of the way.
Yes, amen. You know, the pull is so strong on our young men.
Well, it's all about decisions.
So yes.
The Bible says, choose you this day.
That's right.
As to who you will serve.
That's right.
In my house, I choose to serve God.
It's all about choices.
Amen, amen. And if we make the wrong choices, we can find ourselves in a very bad predicament. I'm so glad that I decided that I didn't want to be a part of a gang activity.
So how did you avoid that?
Well, I played basketball in high school.
Okay.
I stayed busy by doing that. But even there, I had to come back and forth on the bus to come I had to travel several miles from school back to home. And I was approached many, many nights just walking from the bus stop to my home. But I decided I didn't want to be a part of gangs. I just flat outright didn't like what they represented, the things that they were doing. And so I made a decision after I graduated, I had several scholarships, but choices again. My grade average wasn't that great because of the choices that I made, and I started using drugs at a young age as well.
Well, let's talk about that. How did you fall into that?
Well, I started using what I call gateway drugs.
Okay.
The cigarettes, the alcohol, the marijuana.
How old were you?
I was probably around 12 or 13 years old when I first started using marijuana. And I'm not sure if I use it as a crutch because of the turmoil around me. I'm not sure why. I'm not sure if it was peer pressure, but I know that I use drugs just to make me feel better. And actually, I wasn't feeling better. It's like, you ever seen a dog chase his tail around in circles? It was like grasping the wind, as Solomon says, King Solomon says. I couldn't get any satisfaction. But I continue to use drugs. And I must say to our young people today, be smart and don't ever start, because drugs can and will kill you. See, our God has a wonderful plan for laid out for our lives, and if we just take that opportunity, and I wish that I had listened earlier in my life. I went through so much pain and trouble because of drugs, but God was even still with me. Even with the choices that I was making at that time, God continued to love me.
Yes.
Anyway.
Isn't that is what is so great about God. No matter what we do, his love never falters.
Never fails.
We walk away from him.
Exactly.
He never walks away from us.
He's constantly beckoning us to come to him.
Yes, yes. And what you said just a few minutes ago about God having a plan. We always talk about that on this program.
Yes.
God has a plan for each person. Every person has a specific plan that's for their lives, that God wants to give them the abundant life.
Yes.
But choices,
you know,
make a difference.
I have several nephews who are incarcerated today, and I'm constantly writing them letters, and I send them money occasionally. But I tell them this story about two wolves. There's an Indian chief that was telling his grandson a story about two wolves. One wolf represented the fruits of the Holy Spirit, you know, peace, love, and the other wolf represented the evil of the principalities of this world. And they fought and they tussled, and the grandchild finally says, "Grandpa, which wolf won?" He says, "The wolf that you feed."
Ooh.
And we must concentrate, be very careful on what we allow in our minds, be careful where we walk, where we go. We must constantly listen for the voice of the Holy Spirit to lead us, to direct us. I have a couple of nephews who are incarcerated because of drugs on the South Side. They thought that they was going to take the easy way out and make all kinds of money. I never saw them drive a limo or I never saw them living in a house on a hill. They're constantly in and out of jail. And I encourage our young people, don't turn to drugs.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's part of the devil's trap. So he sets up this illusion of wealth and everything is great, and you know, you got if you're a
lot
guy,
of them say, I'd rather work, I'd rather do this than to work at McDonald's and make $4 an hour or whatever
until they're locked up.
Yes, exactly.
And then they're like, why did I go for this?
Yes.
Why did I choose this?
And those drug dealers who claim that they love them, where are they once they're incarcerated? They don't come and make sure that they're visiting them at the penitentiaries that they go into. They go in and find another kid to take prey on. So I encourage our young people, drugs is not the answer. Selling drugs is not the answer. Using drugs is not the answer. The only solution is Jesus.
That's right. And unfortunately, many times you can say that, but the person won't get it until they hit rock bottom.
Yes.
And then they realize, man, I have made the wrong decisions here. I better, where else can they go? It's at that point that they realize, man, I need something different. Tell us what happened to you. Did you hit rock bottom?
Well, I hit rock bottom, yes. I one day I looked in the mirror. Now, this is after several years of using drugs, of course. Now, now first of all, I left Chicago by way of the United States Navy. And when I was in the Navy, all I did was play basketball.
Okay,
I did what I was supposed to do in college.
No drugs.
No drugs. Well, no. I was still using drugs. I was still using these gateway drugs. I wasn't into the heavier drugs like the
cocaine. So they don't test Navy or
When I was in, no, they didn't. They didn't start testing until after I got out.
Oh, okay.
Back in the Vietnam times, it was most of the guys were high on drugs in the Vietnam era. But I used these drugs throughout the military. But one day, I looked in the mirror at myself, and I finally saw what I had become. And I was tired of breaking the heart of people who I loved the most.
Yes.
I was just tired of being tired, of outright being tired. And I cried out, "Dear God, what have I done to myself? I've tried to stop using drugs so many times on my own finite strength, but I just can't seem to do it. I need your divine power to come into my life."
Now, at that point, you were beyond the gateway drugs, correct?
Oh, yes. By that time, I graduated from the marijuana and a couple of glasses of wine and beer to smoking crack cocaine and snorting cocaine. And finally, I began to intravenously use cocaine.
So had you lost the weight that often goes with that, and you're just looking really gaunt and sick?
Actually, I thought that I was in control. In fact, I felt like I was in total control. But yet I was totally out of control. And these are the lies that the enemy will tell you.
That's right. You're
in total control. And I didn't start actually looking at myself until my body started to fall apart. And I started to hear things, and I became schizophrenic and paranoid. Anything that moved in the room, I saw it move. Even if it didn't move, I thought that it moved.
Yeah.
I began to become paranoid, and I thought that everyone was against me. I started hearing voices. I was chasing around, like I said, that dog chasing his tail around in circles. And finally, I looked at myself, and I saw for the first time what I had become. I saw something looking back at me from the reflection of that glass that I didn't care for. I began to reflect on all the time that I wasted, all the scholarships that I passed on, because the drugs were leading me away from the classrooms as opposed to into the classrooms. so many missed opportunities and relationships that were and broken hearts that I just got tired of being tired.
Yes, yes. So let's go back a little bit before the armed services. What or where? Tell us where you hit your lowest point. Where were you at that
point? You know, I had several low points in my life. Even still today, I have low points because, you know, the enemy is constantly, every morning we wake up, we have to expect an attack by the enemy.
That's true.
And God has given me wisdom in my old age to know that I must seek his face in order to combat in all those attacks. But one of the downplays of my life that stands out the most, I guess, this is prior to me going into the military, of course. I was around 11 or 12 years old, and we didn't have a father in our home, but I had a strong black woman as a mother.
Mm.
She raised my seven sisters and my brother and I, and she didn't take no stuff. You know? When she said something, you had to do it.
Otherwise, all right.
You'd be in big trouble.
All right.
But I didn't have a father in my life, and at that time, my mother was my mother and my father. But she made an announcement we were going to go visit with Mr. Harris, and I always wondered why they had separated. You know. And I was born in Indianapolis, as I said earlier. So we had to travel back from Chicago to Indianapolis to visit with him. And as we were going down the highway, in my mind, I began to wonder what we would talk about. Would he play basketball with me? These are the questions that were roaming around my mind.
Did you know who Mr. Harris was?
No, I had never met him.
Okay.
At least I didn't remember him. I didn't remember.
So when she said you were going to meet Mr. Harris, mm-hmm. did she tell you who he was to you?
No, she just says, we're going to visit Dad.
Oh, yes. Okay. So then you started wondering what you were going to do when you visit
and
Dad.
What will we talk about? I was really excited because I was in desperate need of a father.
Of course.
When my mother took us from Indianapolis, she dropped us right smack dab in the middle of gangbangers and drug dealers. But, you know, today as I look back, I realize that God loves even me amongst them. I always wondered why my sisters and I, this particular time it was only three of us in the family, now it's nine of us, but we didn't look anything alike, and I always wondered why. My oldest sister, Gloria, she wrote a song for me, and it went something like this. First there was Gloria Steen, and then there was Virginia Ann, and then we found Michael in a garbage can, because I look so different, you know. We finally arrived in Indianapolis, and I was so excited, I ran into the house even while the car was still slowly moving to the parking space, and I sat on the floor waiting for him to arrive, and my two older sisters followed me, and they sat on the sofa across the room from me, and shortly afterwards in walked Mr. Harris, and as he walked into the room, he was so excited to see Gloria and Virginia. He embraced both of them, and as he was embracing them, I saw that glimmer of pride in his eyes. By now, I'm so excited. And finally, he turns to me, and he has this angry look on his face, and he uttered out these words, "I remember you." And I was wondering, why was this man speaking to me this way? What did I ever do to him deserve a greeting such as this? The father that I traveled so far to meet and the father that I waited so long for is now rejecting me. Why? Well, it came to find out later, they said that I was an accident. They said that I was a big mistake. But I know that God don't make mistakes.
No.
Every man, woman, boy, and girl in this entire world has an awesome purpose in Christ Jesus. So don't ever let anyone ever tell you that you never amount to nothing, because my everlasting Father, my Heavenly Father, has a different opinion. God had me in the palm of his hand.
Absolutely.
When I was conceived.
Absolutely.
And that he has an awesome plan, not only for my life, but for your life and everyone's lives. And that was one of the biggest letdowns in my life. But you know, I grew older, and I was about 15 to 16 playing basketball in high school. And I remember all of my friends would bring their fathers to the basketball games. And I wanted that so much. But my mother was always working, so she never had time.
And it's different.
Yes.
It's different with your mom going to your game
mm-hmm.
from your dad going
yes.
with you to your game.
It means a lot.
The thing that is so, my heart just aches because I know how much this impacts the black community.
Oh, yes, yes.
Period.
A lot of these guys.
Fatherlessness
exactly.
is a huge,
mm-hmm.
huge issue. And
yes.
as I listen to you, the pain that you must have felt.
Oh, yes.
When your dad did not acknowledge you.
He rejected me. But, you know, it came to find out that Mr. Harris was not really my father.
And that's why he.
And that's why. That's why my mother and Mr. Harris were separated, and that's why we moved to Chicago. But I believe that the next time that I journey to meet my father, the next time that I journey to meet him, I believe that he's going to meet me and he's going to greet me and he's going to tell me that I'm his very own. But my only prayer as I sit here with you today is that when I finally see my Heavenly Father face to face, I pray that he will have that glimmer of pride in his eyes.
There you go.
They will whisper in my ear, "Well done,
yes,
my good and faithful servant."
Yes. You were no mistake.
No.
You are your life, the fact that you're here is no mistake.
Amen. Amen.
God's plan for you is that you will take this message. Because so many, as you know, so many of our young men who are incarcerated or who are in gangs or who are in the inner city caught up in crime, they don't have a dad, an earthly dad.
Yes, yes.
So they don't know how to be a man.
They find out how to be a man in the streets.
In the streets.
And there's a lot of mothers with broken hearts out there because their
Absolutely.
Sons are incarcerated. I always thought that I was being cheated out of a relationship with my father.
Mm.
But he was there, my Heavenly Father was there with me the whole time.
That's right.
All those times when I was in my closet using drugs, the massive amount of drugs I was putting in my body, I should have killed myself. I should have died. I shouldn't even be sitting here right now. But he was there with me all the time.
That's right.
Because you see, he saw me right here sitting next to you
That's
today.
That's right.
So when you see someone that's out there who you think that you don't give up on, don't ever give up on anyone, because we don't know what God's purpose is in that person's life.
That's right. What would you tell a young man right now that's caught up into that lifestyle, that has no father, no earthly father, that feels that no one really cares? Mm-hmm. Look into that camera and tell that person just what is on your heart.
We have a Father in heaven that longs to be your Father on this earth. He's hope to the hopeless. He's power to the powerless. And he's a father to the fatherless. And it's his desire that none of us will perish, and he wants us to all experience this joy that surpasses all understanding. You can never find that joy in drugs. You can never find that joy out in the street. There's nothing that compares with what Christ can be to you if you would only allow him in your heart today. Even if you're sitting in a penitentiary right now, we have a God of he's a God of second chances. I'm on my sixth or seventh chance right now. That's how merciful and how he's shown in my life today. So I pray that you'll look to Jesus and give him all that you have, because he loves you with a love that will never stop. And I can honestly say to you that I may not have never met my earthly father, but I have the greatest father in this entire universe. Jesus Christ, he means everything to me.
Thank you. I mean, if our young men could just know that they're not a mistake, that there's a plan for them. I was talking to a young man, Michael, one time that was 17, and he was part of a gang, and he told me, "I don't care if I die. I don't care. It's like there's no value placed on life because they don't have anybody to kind of walk them through." But Jesus will walk you through
Amen.
If you just get
Amen.
To know him.
Amen. And all that pain that you're suffering, and it's evident that it's pain that they're experiencing. That's why they turn away from the family. They turn away from the church, and they turn to drugs. But they need to turn back to the family, turn back to the church.
Yes.
Because that is where they will find that peace.
That's right.
And that
That's
joy
right.
that surpasses all understanding.
That's
there's
right.
Not, you know, there's no drug. I mean, I can say right now, I'm high right now, but it's no drug. High is Jesus right
That's
now.
That's right. That's
and I always
right.
have a smile. I'm always happy. I'm always rejoicing because I find that peace that only he can give.
Yes,
him.
Yes. So how did you find him? You were in the midst of, after you dealt with that rejection, and then you went into the, you started using crack and
yes,
all that,
yes,
and
yes.
went into the military. How did you find Jesus?
Well, I knew that I couldn't keep going in the direction I was going, and my health had failed because of the drugs that I was using. And God kind of got my attention. Sometimes he allows things to happen, you know. God has nothing to do with our misery and our sorrow today. That's all the enemy. Mm. But sometimes God will allow certain things to happen just to get your attention briefly.
Yes, he will.
Sometimes God will, you will end up in penitentiary somewhere. And Moses, he had to go out into the wilderness to understand more about what God's plan was for his life. And sometimes the penitentiary can be your wilderness. But I say this much, you must take advantage of that wilderness that you're in, because that wilderness can turn around and make your life something very wonderful.
Yes.
That Christ has in store for you.
So you can actually be free even while you're in the penitentiary.
Oh, yes, definitely. You know, what bothers me the most, see, I go to different churches. I'm in a different church every Sabbath and a lot of Sundays as well. And I go into schools, and I love going into the schools, but I especially love going into the prisons. But the problem I have here is sometimes I go into a school, and I will go into a prison a year or two later, and I will see some of the same faces that I saw in our schools,
yes,
incarcerated, locked down. And we must come to us, we must find the solution. And we must, as parents, we must, even if you're a single parent, we must strive harder to give our lives to Christ, that they may see a legacy being left behind.
Yes. And we also need for our men that are in the church to take an interest in some of these boys.
Yes, yes.
And you know, one of the things that scares you is because you don't want pedophilia and all,
yes,
that, so you get a little,
yes,
you know, freaked out about that. But our godly men, if they would mentor, mm-hmm, some of these boys who don't... I was watching, as you can tell, I watch TV.
Yeah.
I was watching a program.
Well, you have to stay abreast.
I do. Well, see, that's the thing. So I was watching this, and Steve Harvey was talking about a camp, mm-hmm, that he has for boys,
yes,
and how they have to teach the boys how to tie a tie.
Mm-hmm.
And tears came to my eyes because these are daddy things.
How to respect women.
Yes,
yeah.
How to be in a relationship.
Yes, yes.
How to deal with a person of the opposite sex.
Mm-hmm.
How do you become a man?
Yes, yes.
And a woman, I'm convinced, you can have the greatest mom, mm-hmm, in the world, but a woman can't teach a man to be a man because she's not a man.
Yes.
Just,
yes,
like a man can't teach a girl to be a woman. You need the pair.
All the relationships I've ever had in my life, going back to when I was dating in high school, I've always looked at a woman as a precious jewel,
mm,
because I have a mother.
That's right.
And my mother was a precious jewel. I have seven sisters. I saw each one of them go through their different turmoils with their boyfriends or their husbands. So I know that women are very valuable to us, and we must respect them with all that we have, and because God has placed us in dominion over everything. So we have to be that godly man in a woman's life. And if you have God in your life, if you're seeking first the kingdom of God and all of His righteousness, all these other things will be added unto you.
That's
and you
right.
You will be that representative for Him in the family, in the household, even as you're walking throughout your community,
yes,
at your workplace.
Yes.
That's why we must seek God with all of our heart, and all of our soul, all of our mind.
Absolutely. And if you don't know how to do that, you just get on your knees and say, God, I want to know you better. Show me how to know you better, and get a Bible and begin to read that Bible, and God will reveal Himself to you.
Yes.
We promise. And your life,
amen,
will be so much better.
Amen.
So, back to my other question, how did you find Jesus?
Well, I like I said, I looked in the mirror at myself, and I saw what I'd become, and I was just tired of being tired. And I cried out, dear God, what have I done to myself? I need you in my life today. Because see, as a young man growing up, you know, I was always moved from my mother's house to one of my auntie's house because of the gang violence in Chicago. And I was living with my auntie, who's, in fact, she's going to be 90 years old in June.
Aww,
and
nice.
I'm going to go to Chicago and visit with her and celebrate her birthday. She's a little Pentecostal lady, 90 years old, and she goes to this little storefront church on the south side of Chicago, and she wears these big, big hats, you know. And I remember smelling the cornbread and the collard greens.
Oh, yeah.
And the sweet,
yeah,
potato pie, you know, cooking in the house. But I saw that this woman had an awesome relationship with Christ. And she sang like Mahalia Jackson. So she was a good foundation for me, for my spiritual walk. And I saw how joyful she was as a young man growing up. And I reflected back on all the seeds that she had planted in my life up until that point. And I realized that I needed Jesus in my life. I wanted what my auntie had,
yes,
what she has still today. And that's how I made my turnaround. I knew that there was a way out, and Christ was my way.
And how old were you at this point?
Well, I gave my life to Christ as a teenager, but then by now I'm like in my 30s. And I reflected back on what my auntie had taught me mm-hmm. about Christ. And she said, Michael, you know, if you cry out to Jesus, if you have the faith of a mustard seed, you cry out to that mountain to move, it will move. Uh-huh. I said, no, I ain't read that. Mountain's not going to move. She said, well, no, it's not going to move literally, but circumstances will change for you. And I remembered all those Bible stories that she would tell me. And when I was in my pit of despair, I cried out to Jesus, and he heard my cry, and he began to pull me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay.
Amen.
And he placed my feet on a solid rock, and he put a new song in my mouth to sing praises to his holy name.
Praise the Lord. Mm-hmm. So many people might want to contact you to get you to come to their church and give your testimony and sing. And how can they get in touch with you?
I think they got some information on the screen. I'm not sure, but you can contact me at restorationinthesun, S-O-N, at yahoo.com.
Great.
And I look forward to all the inputs or invites or whatever. God has blessed me. You know, I went from being locked up in my bedroom, poking needles and doing drugs, to getting on the airplane every weekend. I fly all. I've gone to 50 states and 25 countries, and God is good.
God is so good. And so, briefly, tell us, how did you become an Adventist?
Oh, I lived just a couple of blocks from the Shiloh Seventh-day Adventist Church on the south side of Chicago.
Oh.
And I had never heard of the Adventist Church. And when I went overseas, it was a group of Adventist people. You know, in Chicago, only people knocked on my door is Jehovah's Witness.
Right.
But I went overseas, and I was surrounded by these people who I thought were quite peculiar. But they showed the love of God, and I had never seen it demonstrated that way since my auntie and other relatives that I have. And I realized that these people were sent from God to me. But they started talking about worshiping on the Sabbath, on a Saturday, and I knew, for some reason, I couldn't figure that one out. But I began, because of their love, I was drawn to sit down and Bible study with them. And I began to understand God's truths. And I began to understand how much God loved me as well. And that just reinforced my walk with Christ. And now today I've been worshiping on the Sabbath for like 28 years now. So
praise the Lord. Doesn't it make a difference, Michael, when you know your value in Christ? It makes all the difference.
Oh yes,
it
raises the standards in your life, not only in your life but other people's lives, because people will see the Christ in you.
That's
you
right.
Know, we may be the only Bible that some people may ever read.
That's right.
If we're walking with Christ, we can witness without even talking.
That's sometimes. Right. Your life is a sermon.
Amen. Amen.
Well, thank you so much for being with us. You have blessed us.
You've blessed me.
Well, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. That's the end of our program for today. Thanks so much for tuning in. Make sure to join us next time, because you know what? It just wouldn't be the same without you. We'll be right back.